First throw of the qualifying group A for the men's javelin throw. 83 metres needed. And he's popped that out over 75 metres. Set 81.76 this year, the Latvian. And we'll see some rueful looks, some body language at the release saying, I could have thrown that a little further. But it's too late, it's gone. It's gone out of your hand, you've got to go back and you've got to wait probably up to 20 minutes before you get your second attempt, which is part of the challenge of the qualifying round. No wind whatsoever. These javelins, when it was changed in 1986 to make sure the point came down, are dependent on a tailwind, really, for good distances. So it's down to the athlete. If there's no wind, there's no hiding place. So Rocco van Rooyen, the 23-year-old, he's got a personal best of 85.39, but this year, obviously, may have had some problems. That elbow's got a bit of support. That's a fairly typical problem. I've got the scar to prove it, too. So he's up for his first throw. Well, he wins the height record because that nearly went out the stadium at the top. Fortunately, it didn't go very far, so it came down into the field, so gets the red flag. But that, if we'd been in the colder climate, would have had snow on it, I think, that one. It'd be very interesting to watch this boy. I've seen him some throws on coverage from the Diamond League, and I saw his 91.28, and he looks pretty good for a young man. Had memories of a young man that I used to know. So this is Shokir Zhonov of Uzbekistan. Again, short of that 75 metres. Now in the men's, and then he walks out the front, he's not happy with that. In the men's hammer, we had two automatic qualifiers. So the qualifying distances in some of these throws hasn't taken away from the finals, but it's been a bit of a challenge to get the implements out past the qualifying line. And we may be seeing that tonight. 83 metres, we might see three or four. And the next up is Dmytro Kosinski of Ukraine. He has the best of 83.12 this season, and a personal best of 83.39. Well, that's the best throw of the evening so far. Just sneaks over the 80-metre line, although there's no graph, there's no tape at 80 metres. It just goes 75. And then that 83 yellow tape takes it out. So the Ukrainian, 80.08. So he'll take a very early lead after the first four throws of this competition. Strobinders 76.76 in that first round, first throw. So the Sri Lankan Ranasinghe, well, below the 75 meter line, so he won't be threatening that 83 too much, I don't think, this evening. Very tidy on the runway. Blocks and stops, and it's just below the 70-metre mark there shown on that graphic. 69.62 for the Sri Lankan. Next up, Stuart Farquhar of New Zealand. First round throw. Well, just short of 75 metres. Shakes his head a little bit as he sort of collapsed a little bit at the end. Let's have a look at him from this angle. Takes it back nicely, stays side on, but then just collapses that left side. And a low-flighted javelin is always going to come down a little sooner than you would want it to. So 74.24 for Farquhar of New Zealand. Now here we have Vladec of the Czech Republic, 25-year-old, thrown 87-20 this year. That's his personal best. He's thrown it this year. And no doubt he has a little bit of a link to Mr. Zalesny. Three times Olympic champion. And there's the aforesaid. I think he might have shook his head in a little bit of dismay. That he's similar style, takes it round here, but to do that you've got to get out of it, and he doesn't quite do that. Timing not quite right. Javelin point goes up, goes quite high, but then of course what goes up has to come down. It's the laws of gravity. So 78-23 for the Czech Republic man. Risto Matas of Estonian. Next door to the Finns, they've got to have a few javelin throwers around there running through the forests of Estonia. Got a great history in the technical events. And there was a little bit about a Finn there, diving to the floor. They like doing that. We'll see Pitomaki dive on a couple, I think, tonight if we catch him on any of his throws. It's always quite dramatic. I could never work out why they do that, but there you go. Us Brits like to stay on our feet, I guess. So there you go, 76-23 for Matas. And next on the runway will be the young German, the 24-year-old Roller, 91-28 this year. A very exciting talent. Well, it keeps it fairly simple, but it's going to be under 80 metres. So the first through throwers in this group, we've gone through nine up to Roller. Not quite getting it out and up and away like they would like to, so that 83 metres, that automatic qualifying line, is proving a bit of a challenge. 79-47 will be coming up. What great pictures there. Great width in the delivery, but it's a little bit behind him, so he needs to get that going forward a bit. He stopped a bit too quickly at the end there, so we might see some... And this is Leslie Copeland of Fiji. He's over the 75-metre line.
Order of Great Britain, great competitor, medals at the last three World Indoor Championships. She's a quality hurdler. Beside her, the European champion of 2016. Cindy Rolliter. Alina Talay from Belarus is 27 years of age. She was the 2012 European champion. And then the fastest woman in the field, Brianna Rollins, world champion in 2013. She had an exceptional year. She won 33 out of 33 that year. They couldn't get anywhere near her. So she'll be heavily favoured to get one of the two automatic spots. Here's the French woman, a two-time French champion, Sandra Gomis. And from the lane which will be closest to camera, Padria Seymour of the Bahamas, just 21 years of age. She is the youngest woman in this field. She's got four Bahamas records so far in 2016. Rollins, without question, the favourite here to get through. Tiffany Porter will be amongst the runners who will have high hopes of getting through to the final. Rollins normally clean and quick early, and her competitors will know whether she's on probably by the time they've gone over the second flight. Rollider goes from five. First semi-final, two guaranteed places in the final later on tonight. Rollins left well enough, and now she starts accelerating. Already she's in front at the third flight from Rollider. Porter's going well. Rollins looks good, though. She's got a couple of metres advantage, and she's going to come away, and the automatic spot goes to Seymour from the Bahamas. One of the runners pulled up in the middle of the field, and it was Talley, and just caught the eye of a couple of the runners as she did. But Rollins never really troubled. 12:47, so she hasn't broken any records there, but she didn't need to. All she needed to do was to be clean and clear, and she was both. But what about that from Pedria Seymour, the youngest woman in the semi-final? She's run a national Bahamas record, and she's already got four of those so far this year. She's got another one, a national record, and she is in the final. Rollin has gone 12:69, and Porter's gone 12:82.
Well, Brianna Rollins was the last to settle in the blocks. She's third from the left-hand side. Watch Talley on the lane just up in the red. That was the hurdle she clattered. A brilliant finish from the Bahamian, but that was so, so smooth.
She's running, takes it back, nicely straight up, turned around, head up, over the top, keep it simple. He's nailed that comfortably over the 83-metre automatic qualifying line shown in the field. Great width in that striking stride, that last stride. Blocks and takes a stride and a half to recover. 84:46 for Weber. He goes through, boots off. And the ladies in the long jump come out. The 12 top qualifiers from the qualifying round come out, and Brittany Rees, the reigning Olympic champion, comfortably qualified with her first jump. And she is a pretty good favourite for the gold here this evening in Rio, but we've seen some favourites fall in the field events. Valerie Adams got mugged by Michelle Carter in the women's shot put.
Now the second semi-final of the women's 100 metres. Well, Brianna Rollins has just made very smooth passage through to the final. Will it be the same for her compatriot Nia Ali, the two-time world indoor champion who starts in lane five? Felicity of George of Canada outside her in six, and the very quick improving Puerto Rican Jasmine Camacho Quinn in seven will fancy they can produce something very special in this race. A balmy evening, and we will gear up to a great climax at the end of the night. Celia Reusrad of Switzerland, twice a national indoor champion, PB this year, 12:87. You'd think it would need quicker than that to make it through to the final. Toby Amuzan, fifth in the world juniors earlier this year, still a teenager. What an occasion for someone still 19 years of age. It's the Olympic semi-finals, amazing. Nadine Hildebrand, semi-finalist in Moscow, world indoor finalist in Istanbul in 2014. She lost most of last year to a knee injury. Good to see her back. Then Nia Ali, the fastest in this field, 12:48 her PB. She's gone 12:55 this year. Fifth fastest in the world in 2016. She knows this is a great opportunity and seems fairly relaxed there. Felicia George, fifth in London, seventh in Daegu the year before. She came through second in her heat. Her PB's 12:65. There or thereabouts would be enough, you suspect, from this second semi-final. And then the fast-improving Puerto Rican, US collegiate champion, Jasmine Camacho Quinn, 12.69 this season, Maybe she can be inspired to even faster here in these semis. Nurulotta Naziri of Finland, semi-finals in the Euros earlier this year in Amsterdam. Big, powerful young woman. And on the outside, Nikisha Wilson. She's been around a really long time. Fourth in the 400 hurdles, way back in the sweltering conditions of Osaka in 2007. Not too dissimilar tonight in the stadium. It's absolutely baking with barely a breath of wind. Right, top two to go through then. Nia Ali should be the quickest here in five. There's an opportunity for another athlete to make it through. Will it be George of Canada? There she is. She'll be running in lane six on Nia Ali's right. And will the young Puerto Rican in seven continue a great year? Anxious moments, so easy for something to go wrong, even for the very best in the world. Second semi, women's 100 hurdles. George took a little while to settle into her blocks. That's a good start from Nia Ali. And Camacho Quinn trying to come up onto the shoulder of the Canadian. Nia Ali is not having this all her own way. Oh, real stumble there. Nia Ali takes it from Felician George. And what a shame for Camacho Quinn. She was right in the mix coming down the last two barriers. And she's absolutely heartbroken because she clattered one of the hurdles. And just at the point at which you thought she and the Canadian would put Nia Ali under pressure, it unraveled for the Puerto Rican, but there was good composure there from both Nia Ali at 12.65 and Felicia George at 12.77.
Well, you said it so prophetically before the race. It only takes one little thing to go wrong. Look at the lady, three from the left of your picture. She's going really well. They were both pushing Ali, and then look what happens to the Puerto Rican there. She lost her balance there, hit the next hurdle, couldn't get over the next one, and she was down on the track and completely inconsolable for about 20 seconds or so, and then she's picked herself up to her credit. That is such a shame. She was right up there for a qualifying spot.
I think she would have come past the Canadian. Her momentum was bringing her through the race, but we've seen that so many times before. Third from the left, Camacho Quinn hits that one, and then it's all over. Even the great Gail Devers almost ran too quickly for the hurdling stride pattern that she had, and even she came unstuck. So I know she'll be devastated, but following her on the American Collegiate Circuit this year, she's had an absolutely brilliant year. And when one of the coaches gets hold of her and says, listen, I'm not going to tell you it's okay, you need to cry and get this out of your system, but you will bounce back from this because you've improved a lot already this year just to get into the Olympic semi-finals.
And meanwhile, down the other end of the stadium, this is Roller from Germany, stalking around, getting ready for his second round throw. As Jakub Vadlec of the Czech Republic steps onto the javelin runway for his second throw, 78-23 on his first throw. Well, it's a little bit better. It's crept over 80 metres. He's still short of the automatic qualifying distance of 83. He has thrown 87 metres 20 this year. And is sixth in the world rankings with that distance. But a long way back from the line. So had he got his run up, I know he's stopped just beside the line, but he could have put the brakes on a decent throw. So he goes to his distance of over 80 metres. And the next one up is Risto Matas of Estonia, 76-23 on his first round throw. Dramatic collapse at the end of the runway. just short of 80 metres, 78.23 on that first round. So it may be a slight improvement for the Estonian. And he improves to 79.26, currently in fifth position for Mattis.
Well, what a shame for Camacho Quinn, just on the left of picture. But as far as Nia Ali is concerned, another good qualification from her. Ali and George safely through to the final. 12.65 for Nia Ali, 12.77 for Felicia George, and that means Cindy Rollader and Tiffany Porter still occupy the fastest loser spots at 12.69 and 12.82. One more to come.
So the ladies over the other side of the stadium getting ready to get involved in their long jump final. This is Daria Klishina, the Russian competitor. Ivana Spanovic waving to the crowd and getting involved.
Here's the third semi-final coming now. So the times that they've got to beat if they don't run either first or second. First of all, 12.69 for Cindy Rollader, 12.82 for Tiffany Porter. They're the two that are in at the moment. Two automatic spots, the potential for four of these women to go through. Cindy Bilot, 2014 European Championship silver medalist. She's one of the quick women in the field here, second quickest at 12.56, but she's only gone 12.83 this year, and she is going to need to be quicker than that. Nikita Holder of Canada, at 29 years of age, will need to improve a fair bit on her times. 2011 World Championship finalist. She's only run 12.92 this year, so that presents a big task here against the likes of the woman who is on her right shoulder, Christy Caslin of the United States of America. Her personal best has been recorded this year. She looks so good in the heats. 2012 US Indoor Champion, so she's in personal best shape. Anna Zagre of Belgium, Belgian record holder. She's run 12.70 and change this year. Here's Cindy Ofili of Great Britain, just 22 years of age. She's such a promising talent. 12.60 is her lifetime best. She's gone just outside that this year. US collegiate champion indoors. Megan Simmons of Jamaica, the 2016 Jamaican champion, goes out of lane seven. Pamela Dutkiewicz of Germany has won the West German indoor title in 2015. And on the outside lane is Isabella Pedersen of Norway, Norwegian Athlete of the Year in 2015. Caslin, Ofili, maybe below, but she is going to have to improve on what she's done so far this year. She's the oldest woman in the field at 30 years of age, Cindy Bilot. Caslin is a great talent. She comes out of lane four. There's Ofili of Great Britain, also right in hot contention for a spot to go through to the final later on tonight. Beside her, Zagre of Belgium. Caslin taking plenty of time, and she's not the only one. Zagre is also going to make them wait. Have a little think about what's going on, what's about to happen over the next 12 and a half seconds or so. K Caslin got off to a good start. Zaga away okay. Simmons began really well. She's in front. It's Simmons leading. Caslin coming through now. Caslin's got the lead. One goes down. There were a couple of incidents in the race. Zagra's got up for second. Caslin has eventually got there. It was Simmons of Jamaica who led them down, but there were hurdles being knocked down. There were hurdles being clattered into. And, in fact, it is Zagra who's come down, and it is O'Feely who has got through and got the qualifying spot. It was in the middle lanes where all the action was happening. So it's Caslin defeating O'Feely, 12.63 and 12.71. So the Brit has got through, and Pedersen at 12.88 has missed out. So it's going to be Porter and Rollida that will get through. But there are all sorts of things catching your eye in that race, and it took a while for Christy Caslin to get there.
Well, watch the tiny Jamaican, third from the left-hand side. She got an absolutely brilliant start, and then she stuttered into one barrier, hit another one, and her quest came to an end. Pedersen was trying to come through on the near side. Really good finish from the American, Christy Caslin. Her, Brianna Rollins, and Nia Ali look very, very good indeed. And both the British sisters will be in the final because Cindy's come through for that second automatic spot. And Pedersen finishing in third was slower than Tiffany Porter's time from the first heat. So we'll have two Britons and three Americans in the final. But desperate scenes there. Second from the right-hand side. That was Nikita Holder. She'd clattered a barrier. Zagra had already gone. That was the point at which the Canadian hit the deck. So we lost two there in a really dramatic finish. Well, we said it can all happen in the hurdles, and so it proved.
12.63 for the winner, 12.71 for the runner-up.
And here we come, Thomas Roller in the javelin in the second round. The German coming out for his second throw. He's short, his compatriot Weber went clear of the 83 line with 84.46. Nice high carry at the back. Clean through the point. But it's not automatic qualifying for Roller, who leads the world rankings this year. 81.61 puts him second behind his German colleague, who's gone automatic with 84.46. Now this is Brian Toledo of Argentina, the 22-year-old, who's had prodigious distances as a junior. Now competing in the senior competitions, lines it up nicely, keeps control, stands up nice and tall. It's not complicated. We like that. Keep it nice and easy. It's not automatic, but it's over 80 metres for the young Argentinian. ...81.96... and he's now up above Roller and holds that second spot in this Group A qualifying round.
Out on the warm-up track, there's plenty of action for the 200 metre athletes, including the great LaShawn Merritt. Having a look at the draws for the 200, one man's name dominates, that man, Bolt, Usain Bolt. You might have heard of him. LaShawn Merritt goes in semi-final number one. Bolt goes in semi-final number two. Andre de Grasse will go against Bolt in semi-final number two. And Justin Gatlin will go from lane three in semi-final number three. He fancied his chances of beating Bolt in the 100. He wasn't able to do it. Johan Blake, always competitive, second behind Bolt in the London final, beaten by 0.12 of a second in the 100, by 0.12 of a second also in the 200. That's coming up shortly, the time for the victory ceremony for the women's 1500 metres. What a brilliant performance it was by the gold medalist in Faith Kipyegon. It was a race that promised so much, and for the United States in some way, it certainly delivered, because they've never won a medal in this event. And Jennifer Simpson was able to put paid to that unwanted record. 29 years of age, she's been around a long time now. The world champion of 2011. Fantastic finish from the 29-year-old. And so she stands on the dais and does something that no American has ever done in this great event, the 1500 metres. US Track and Field's Female Athlete of the Year in 2014. And she's proven a worthy ambassador for her country today. The woman who was perhaps favourite for the race, Genzebe Dibaba, held most of the things you'd want to hold. Coming into the race, she held the world championship. She held the world record. But she couldn't hold Faith Kipyegon when it turned into a sprint down the back. Hasn't had the most ideal of preparations going in. There was just a little question mark on her, and you have to be at your absolute peak if you're going to stand on the top step of that dais. Smile from the 22-year-old. She went to her first Olympic Games 4 years ago in London as an 18-year-old and went out in the first round of the 1500. And as a more mature athlete, she went to the World Championships at Beijing and took the silver medal in the 1500. And now she stands up there on the biggest stage of them all. The Olympic champion representing this great distance-running nation of Kenya at just 22 years of age. Faith Kipyegon is the Olympic champion. In Rio, we wonder in 4 years' time whether she'll be back. She'll only be 26 years of age when she goes to Tokyo, so she's going to be a force to be reckoned with there. But such is the depth of the Kenyan athletes, you never know whether she'll even make it through, because there'll probably be another couple of Faith Kipyegons coming through over the next 4 years.
I think there's another instalment of rivalry between Faith Kipyegon and Genzebe Dibaba. Let's not forget, Dibaba had a really injury-ravaged year, and she'll be smarting from that going into the World Championships next year. Now, what a crazy topsy-turvy three semi-finals we had in the women's 100-metre hurdles. But we've got the qualifiers.
And Caslin and Afili were the last of the qualifiers. It was Zagra who hit a hurdle, and then it was Holder who came crashing down. And what that means is the qualifiers are decided, and it is hard to see Brianna Rollins being beaten on what we've seen so far. 12.47. She's 0.16 quicker than Caslin. Caslin can't beat Rollins if she gets a similar start to the one she got in the semis. So Brianna Rollins from the United States, the fourth fastest woman of all time in the 100 metres hurdles, is the favourite for the gold medal in Rio.
And we are now going to be introduced to the women in the final of the long jump, which is taking place at the far side, the back straight of the stadium. So this is the start list. This is the jumping order. And they'll be introduced to the crowd along with the accompaniment of the drummers. The great innovation for the field events. And here they go. So, the first up and first to jump will be Malaika Mihambo of Germany. 22-year-old. Has a season's best of 6.82. Personal best of 6.90 meters. Next up, second in the field will be... yeah, when you walk through, you've got to move on. Daria Klishina of Russia eventually gets into the competition.
Next in the order, twice the world champion
and
for the USA.
Tiana Bartoletta, 30-year-old from the USA, 6.82 this year. She was the world champion in 2005, age 19, and then the world champion in 2015, 10 years between at 29. Next up is Ksenia Balta of Estonia. Marina Beck of Ukraine, the 21-year-old, with a best of 6.93. And that's her best this season too. Jasmine Sawyers from the UK, the Great Britain athlete, 22-year-old, 6.75. And she looks as though she's enjoying herself. Brittany Rees, the reigning Olympic champion, the 29-year-old, 7 metres 31 in 2016. That Olympic record from Jackie Joyner-Kersee, 7 metres 40. Could it be under threat tonight? Sosthene Mogwana Nara of Germany, 7 metres 16. Oh, we're dancing. We like it. Lorraine Ugin. Yeah, she's bound to get a medal now. She's joining in. The crowd will love her. Yeah, there you go. You see, all you got to do is show some steps. Get involved in the process. Lorraine Ugin, 6.93. That's her personal best, and it's set this year. Ivana Spanovic, the leading qualifier from the group stage. 7.07 this year, the 26-year-old. Esther Broom of Nigeria, and she's got a good samba in her, I can tell. I'm the expert now, having called these all week. I can see movement when I want to see it. And last but not least, we have Brooke Stratton, 7.05 this year from Australia, the new OCN record holder. So the drummers drum on. Javelin, meanwhile, continues at the third far end of the stadium. We're into the final third three throws. This is Koskinski of the Ukraine. We've had one automatic qualifier. Now we've got two. Just over that line. Doesn't matter how far it goes over in this qualifying stage. You've just got it. Get it over. Now, he had 80.08 on his first throw. 76.79 on his second throw, and now he goes in boots off phase because he's got an automatic qualifying on his third throw. Good slow motion replays, good width on that delivery stride, stays nice and tall, follows through, and it's the thumbs up for the 27-year-old Ukrainian. So, first to jump, Malaika Mihambo of Germany. Well, it's out in the pit towards seven, but I'm not sure that her... She gets the white flag. She got a good position on the board. It looked as though she might have transgressed, but no. And she's got a season's best of 682. She's just short of that placing, but that's perfect placing. Great positioning. On and 683 is the season's best into a minus 0.8 wind. So the next to jump is Daria Klashina, the Russian, who has got a personal best of 7 metres 05. Trains in the USA. Pioneers in that sprinting action. Busy arms. And that's a good opening jump from the Russian. Klashina gets the white flag. Just shortens that stride, which is so typical of just the adjustment. The radar goes up and you've got to get that foot, that takeoff foot on the board. So Klashina waiting for that 663. So two good jumps in the first two jumps of this long jump, women's long jump final.
Now the big boys are coming out. They're not quite as weary this time today as they will be this time tomorrow. But they've got to round off their first instalment of five with the 400 metres. Ashton Eaton is leading, but probably not by quite as much as he would have liked or he would have thought after four events. He goes in the fourth of the 400s, along with the man who's just behind him, Damien Warner of Canada. They finished first and second last year in Beijing at the World Championships. And who could forget Ashton Eaton's incredible run in the 1500 in fairly muggy conditions in Beijing to beat the world record. Four in total then. Eaton and Warner to come in the fourth. This is the first. Rico Freimuth, disappointment for him. He's not taking part. Neither Elko Saint-Niklas. So lanes five and six will be empty here. We've got Keisuke Ushiro on the inside and right on the outside, Adam Helselet. Fourth in Moscow, just missing a medal. He's 11th overall. He says, listen, decathlon isn't a sport, it's a way of life. 48.66 is lifetime best, but he's yet to go inside 50 seconds this year. Then three from the inside is Labi Burada. Now, what a great Olympic Games he's having so far. 2:10 in the high jump. He had the stadium all to himself. He was fifth in Beijing with a new African record. He's lying sixth overall at the moment. Ushiro of Japan goes in one. Uibo of Estonia, who had a no mark in the shot put, he's in two. Burada, Algeria, three. Tonnesen of Spain in four. Van der Platsen, the Belgian who's come back from testicular cancer to be competing again, he's in seven. And Helselet's on the outside in eight. Cameras focusing in on Burada. And there's a Japanese athlete on the inside. But Burada catching the eye as a result of having such a good day so far. All these men have run 50-plus change this season. Can Helselet, starting on the outside, give himself the perfect finish to day one and move his way up into the top ten after the fifth event? Well, it's a long hold, and these big fellas will be more than happy to get day one completed. Burada's gone out fairly quickly. He's closing in on Tonnesen down the back straight. Looks fairly level between Helselet and Van der Platsen. Helselet on the extreme left of picture there, and Burada's really going for this. It's fabulous to see the Algerian nation well represented in the decathlon. He's already made up the stagger on Van der Platsen, and it's Burada coming in to the home straight. Well, he had the stadium all to himself in the high jump, and that's the same again here. An absolutely fantastic performance from the Algerian, tying up a little bit, those big shoulders rocking and rolling. Helselet's wading through treacle. He comes home second, 47.99. Wow, it's not too far outside his lifetime best. That is a great run.
Brittany Rees, first jump in the long jump final. The reigning Olympic champion, the 29-year-old, has jumped 7.31 this year. It's a season's best and her personal best. Well, she's over 7 metres, but she's going to get the red flag on that one. She's well over the plasticine. Could see that from the screen. And meanwhile, Jakub Vadlec of the Czech Republic steps up for his third round throw. 83 is needed to automatically qualify. They're incredibly bunched up in this Group A qualifying round for the javelin. Oh, there you go, 83. It's a bit crab-like on the... I'm not wishing to have a pop at Mr. Zalesny here, but, you know, you need to look at it a little smoother. He's sort of like ganglion, feet going all over the place. But doesn't matter what he looks like, if you get the return over that yellow 83 line mark, there it is. He qualifies automatically for the final. Mr. Vadlec of the Czech Republic. Waiting for that distance curve, 83.27. So he's made a mark and he goes through to the final. So first attempt for Mogu Nara of Germany. Cuts a stride. We saw Brittany Rees have that long jump, but gets a red flag. This 26-year-old German gets the white flag. On it, the board with that left foot takeoff, perfectly placed. She couldn't have been better placed for the takeoff. Slightly angled in the air. She needs to straighten that out because she'll get greater height if she does. 6.61 puts her fourth, as she's the eighth to jump in the first round. Ninth up is Lorraine Ugin. She deserves to jump well just for the dancing she did at the beginning. Ugin on the runway. Well, it's very straightforward, but what a good opening jump by Ugin, the Briton. Great on the board with that right foot takeoff. She's out close too, towards 7 metres. It's late sixes. Could have extended that right foot, just comes down a little early. If she just kept the extension going, 6.56 for Ugin. And Spanovic is next up. It's fast and furious over at the long jump. Ivana Spanovic, the 26-year-old Serbian, best of 7.07. She was the top qualifier in the qualifying group phase. What can she do in this first round of the women's long jump final? Well, there's the answer to that. It's over 7 metres for Spanovic. Unless there's a hand come down. No, the arms are up. Great on the board. Great height. Great leg extension. Look at that. Ugin could have done that and she would have gained another 20 centimetres. Fantastic jumping from Spanovic. All just short of 7, 6.95, but she's the leading jumper. There's two more to follow her as the long jump hots up.
Well, how could it not? It's a very, very warm evening. And that was a pretty warm performance from Lavi Barada. He'll be very happy with his day's work. 910 points for the Algerian. He's had a cracking first day and he'll be away to rehydrate and prepare for the second half of his epic battle to come.
In the second heat, we have a couple not going here. Andreev of Uzbekistan and the South African William Kurtzen also not going. So a field of six, and we've got a couple of the top 10. Kevin Meyer of France, who will go from lane number one, is in fourth spot. Much of the crowd's attention will be taken by Luis Alberto de Araujo. He's in the top dozen. And they are greeting him as a hero, as they have done with all of the Brazilian athletes. Kurt Felix is in eighth place. The man from Grenada. He's got a 48.63. Fastest man in the field here is Leonel Suarez of Cuba. Kevin Mayer, well, it looked as though he was going to pull out of the high jump at 2.04. Had some sort of foot injury, went up, tipped the bar off for his second attempt, and then thought, oh, well, while I'm here, I may as well have a look at it. And he cleared 2.04. So get ready for this place to rock if the Brazilian is able to get himself up near the front of this race. He goes from lane six. The Cuban, Leonel Suarez, as we said, is the fastest man in the field, but not this year. Out they go. Second heat of the men's four. And Oziel on the outside will have a long lead simply because there was a vacant lane inside him. Brazilian crowd roaring as their runner, De Araujo, goes down the back straight. Suarez getting up to him. And Felix is running really well from Grenada. And they've left the other two behind in Visiolek and Meyer. Meyer starting to make some ground now as they come off the back. Have a listen to this. The Brazilian hit the front momentarily. He's been rounded up by Felix, but the crowd will carry him. And look at Meyer coming from all the way back now. The wall of noise carrying the Brazilian. Is it going to get him to the line? It might nearly do it. It did. And wait until the confirmation goes up. Luis Alberto de Araujo has got there. And I have no doubt that the wall of noise carried in there. The result goes up on the board. And that is as loud as we've heard the Olympic Stadium throughout this track and field competition. And it's only a heat of the 400 metres. That was a stirring moment. Brazil, Cuba, France. Good run from Meyer. Suarez ran well too.
Roller in the javelin in that third round does the automatic qualifying. So from that group, you couldn't get closer to the line. We're just going to see the distance come up. Lines this up really nicely. That left foot goes out a little too far, but he gets hold of it, and it's over the qualifying line of 83 metres by a whisker. But that's all you need to make it automatic. 83.01. How precise could you be more than that? 83.01 for Roller. Pitamaki coming up for his last round. Are we going to see the end of an era with Pitamaki getting into finals and performing well at the World Championships? The 33-year-old needs to get over 80 metres, or over 83 would be better. The body language says it all. It's below 80 metres. It's probably his best attempt so far. Typically fast on the runway, wraps up, dives on release, or just after release, and that javelin sails out, but he's short of that automatic line at 83, short of 80, 79.56 is his best, and he currently sits in eighth position, and there's still quite a few more to throw after him. Well, I can give you the update, here it is. Pitamaki ends up in 10th with 79.56. Four automatic qualifiers. In 6th place is Robinson of Australia, 80.84. Keep a mindfulness of that 80.84, because he's in 6th. Every throw over 80.84, he drops down one. And he'll be sitting nervously watching that from the stand when the qualifying group, B group, come out. So, Bartoletta on the runway. No jump on the first one. That's pretty tidy. She gets the white flag. Well, that's important too, because that no jump in the first round would have put pressure on her for a third jump if it was a no jump this time. She's very active in the air. She gets her hips really high off that board. Mouth open as she extends those legs into the pit. And coach goes boom. 6.94, and she moves into second place. that will be a season's best, because we haven't got a mark for during 26. Yes, we have 682. It is a season's best for Bartoletta, 694. And she moves into second place currently in the long jump final.
Well, if ever there was an example of a crowd carrying someone to glory, even if it was just a heat of the 400 decathlon, it was that. You could visibly see Deja Roja accelerate in the last 70 metres. Brilliant moment here in the stadium.
And it was a personal best performance, so a good time to do that.
So, next up on the runway is Jasmine Sawyers of Great Britain. 6.55 on her first jump. It's hotting up over there. Reese had a no jump. It was long. She's going to get the crowd going. They liked her dancing to the samba as she was introduced to the crowd. So Sawyers, 6.55 on her first jump. Well, we'll wait for the white flag, but that's a slight improvement for Sawyers. Yep, she gets the white flag. Good on the board, good speed, great height off the board off that takeoff foot. Perfect on the board. Look at her, closing her eyes, wincing, trying to get up high off that takeoff foot. 6.69, she improves into sixth in the second round.
Look at this. The crowd carrying this man to victory. He still wasn't going to get there until right there. And he's got there, and he's run a personal best. The Brazilian, De Arroyo, at 48.14, a personal best. 48.15 for Suarez. Myers run well to get 48.28, and the first two get 902 points.
Now Reese needs to adjust her radar. She fouled the first attempt. It was long. It looked like it was well over 7 metres, but it doesn't count if you put your foot over that board. Well, she's got great speed. She gets the white flag. And the one thing she seems to have more than others is that height off the board. Just watch this. Up she goes. And that leg extension wasn't really fully extended. It was safe, that one. She's missed the board, actually. She's short of it. But those legs need to really extend. And she's got plenty of time up there. She gets great height off the board. So Reese in business. 6.79, but she holds fourth position at this stage of the competition in the second round.
Well, no Brazilians in this one, but we have a couple of Americans, and hopefully they'll get the crowd fired up. Great moments here at the end of day one, and these big fellas really deserve to have the applause and the support of the crowd. There's Jeremy Tayu. He's lying in third place overall, 2.19 in the high jump, following in the footsteps of his dad, an Olympic triple jumper back in the day in LA and in Seoul. Didn't finish in Moscow or Beijing, but this is going better so far, touch wood. And Zach Zimek on the inside for the United States, third in the national champs last year and this year. He jumped 2.10. Garcia just outside him, the Cuban. Watch out for Dudas as well. He's lying 13th overall, European bronze medalist. He's gone under 49 seconds this year. So it's Zimek of the USA, Garcia, Cuba, Dudas, Serbia, Tayo, United States, third overall, Sikora of the Czech Republic in six, Arbel of Germany in seven, Kazyanov, the big Ukrainian on the outside, twice a world indoor silver medalist. So Dudas has gone inside 49 seconds this year. Can he put the Americans under pressure here at the end of a very long day? Well, Jeremy Tayu's fabulous performance in the high jump has given him a platform to round off a great day here. Garcia, the Cuban, has already taken out the stagger on Dudas, and coming through on the inside, Zimek. So those three running together. No big move yet from Tayu, and third from the left-hand side, Zikora of the Czech Republic, trying to eat up the stagger on Arbel of Germany, and Kazyanov, who's really struggling here. On the inside, Zimek, the American, he comes in to the home straight first. Tayu, very upright, Garcia trying to come through now as Zimek begins to tie up. And it's going to be the Cuban here, and on the outside, Kozyanov. Well, he's found his legs. Kozyanov takes it on the line from Garcia over in lane two. Good run there from the man who only just missed a medal in Berlin. Well, it looked like he was going backwards as he came into the home straight, but he found his rhythm. Useful points for the Ukrainian, comfortably inside 49 seconds.
Spanovic, 6.95 in the first round, lining up for her second jump in this women's long jump final. Well, we're waiting. No, it's a red flag. She's gone over. So we've seen the 7-meter line cleared tonight, but both have been no jumps. First, Reese went over, and coach holds his head. It was a good jump, but unfortunately, it's null and void with that foot in the plasticine. And Group B of the men's javelin come out to take battle. Four automatic qualifiers in Group A eventually warmed up. The first round was pretty slow, but it got warmer as it went on. 83 metres they need to do that. From that first group, sixth position, 80-84. They'll be aware of that. They'll know that, but they'll want the automatic qualifying because that's the way you get into the final, by doing that. Walcott, second to throw, is the defending Olympic champion, the youngest ever to win a javelin event at 19. And Julius Yego of Kenya, the current world champion in this group, along with other world-ranked athletes, Antti Ruskanen of Finland and Sumays of Latvia. Johannes Vetter, another German, is second ranked. So the Germans very strong-handed in this javelin event. They have Roller and Vetter at the top of the world rankings, and Weber was the leading qualifier from Group A. So there is Vetter of Germany marking out his run-up as they go through the ritual. This is Sigismunds Zirmes of Latvia. And there's Julius Yego, the shortest javelin thrower in the world, operating at this level. And he's got a personal best of 92.72. That was a new Commonwealth record. Took the record off a man I know right quite well. But he wouldn't begrudge him that. And here we have Brooke Stratton in the long jump from Australia. Second round, no jump on that first attempt. Well, she gets the white flag. And we'll wait. The 23-year-old Australian, 7.05 this year. Good on the board. Short of 7 metres, but short on the border slightly. She's just about crept onto it with the front spikes. But 6.69 puts her in eighth position at the conclusion of the second round. Now, eighth position is really important because eight athletes go through. They make the cut, they reverse the order, and we have three more jumps. So this is Malaika Mahambu of Germany. 6.83, followed by a no jump. So she starts the third round of jumps. Mahambu of Germany. Well, it was a red flag. It was very flat, so she must have infringed that plasticine at the front of the board, all by a whisker. Minus one, it says. The technology is telling us. Who are we to disagree? So she'll have to wait nervously now. 6.83. Well placed, though, for the top eight. We saw Brooke Stratton of Australia go into eighth position with 6.69. And the Australian will be the last jumper to go in the third round. And then we'll get a reshuffle of the pack. So, at the moment, Kleshina sitting in ninth position. She's out of the top eight. So this jump becomes very important indeed. 669 is eighth currently. In the region of that 669 jump by Brooke Stratton, the Australian, at the conclusion of the second round. We've got the graphic line there. She's way, way short of the board, really. 18 centimetres, and it's 6.53. So Pashina won't be making the top eight with that jump.
Corner, and so the lead of 68 points after round four will stretch, and we'll know by how many, because he's earned 1,005 points, Eaton, for that. Kazmarek's run an equal personal best of 46.75. Warner, 47.35, gains 941 points. So Eaton has gained 64 points on the Canadian.
Bartoletta, third jump of this final. Having had a no jump to start off with, she's looking good now. 6.94, just 1 centimetre behind Spanovic, who jumped 6.95 in the first round, 16 centimetres short of the plasticine, so just on the board. Those legs not really fully extended into the pit. 6.95, she goes top of the board because of her backup jump of 6.94.
There's the big man waiting to come out. Semi-finals of the men's 200 metres. Just around the corner. By the way, there's been a change in the order in the decathlon. Kazmarek has moved his way up to second. Warner now third.
Well, here we have Brittany Rees, the defending champion of the women's long jump. She had a no jump followed by 6.79. 6.95 leads her compatriot Bartoletta, 30 years of age, has jumped 6.95, a season's best. Rees, 7.31 this year. Third round, women's long jump final. Well, the red flag again, but it's over seven. She gets prodigious height off. Oh, look at that. That's minus two. That's just a fraction over. So she's on the board, but she's infringed into that plasticine. So she'll be taking 6.79 through to the last three rounds. An adjustment needed to be made on that run-up. She currently is in fifth position in the final of this women's long jump. So here we have the next lady to jump, Sothene Moguanara of Germany. 6.61 on her first jump. No jump on her second. Currently in 10th. Stutters into that take-up point. So she gets the white flag, but she sits just outside the top eight. So we'll see, as a result of this jump, where she's going to be. She wanders around the run-up. Those long legs just losing their position as she comes down. Coach shaking his head because 7.16 this year. 6.61, no jump, 6.46, and she's out of the top eight. So a disappointing end to her long jump pursuit of the gold medal. Lorraine Ugun, currently lying in 11th. To get into the top eight, she's got to jump over 6.60 comfortably. Well, it may be, but it's got the graphic there of the eight. We're just waiting for that distance. She gets the white flag. She's well onto the board. Ugin. Brooke Stratton of Australia holds that eighth position with 669, 658. So Ugin finishes in 11th with 658. So thumbs going up for Brooke Stratton, who's last to jump, and he's watching these other ladies in this competition attack that eighth position that she's sitting in. So Ugin doesn't get there. 658 is her best jump in that third round. Spanovic is already ahead of her, 695 on that first jump. She's now in the silver medal position because of countback. She needs to go over 695, or 695 again would put her in the first spot. Spanovic, third jump in this long jump final. Oh, what a great jump that is. Let's see if she gets the white. Oh, no, it's red again. So the really long jumps are getting red flags. It was a very close call. And we'll have a look. Both Rees and Spanovic over 7 metres. But unfortunately, it's foul time. They're putting their foot over the board and they get the cross against their name.
And there's Ashton Eaton striding away and looking for every tenth of a second he could possibly get. And picking up a few more points at the end, getting it over the 1,000. 46.07 gives him 1,005 points. Kaczmarek, very good performance. Equal personal best, 9.71. That's going to elevate him. Warner, 9.41 for his 47.35. Also a personal best for the Australian doubler. These are the standings at the end of what has been a grueling first day. And Ashton Eaton has the lead, but now he has the lead over Kai Kaczmarek. And the margin between them is 121 points. Only 11 points further back is Warner of Canada. Meyer of France is fourth. Taiwo of the USA is fifth. And Barada, who's had a very good high jump and a very good 400 metres. So he's had a good end to the day. And the Algerian has moved up to sixth place. But Ashton Eaton leads, and leads by 121 points in his quest for glory in Rio in the decathlon. And they can drag their weary bodies out of bed early tomorrow morning and do it all again, beginning with the 110 metres hurdles.
Should be a cracking second day, that. I'm not sure Eaton's as far ahead as he would have hoped after the first day. And Warner will fancy he can close the gap.
So Brooke Stratton clung on to the eighth position. She's secure now. She knows that she's in eighth. She'll have this jump, the third round conclusion, and then she'll be first up in the second phase of the competition. Unless she goes further than 669. Gets the white flag. So 673 currently, 675 currently in. I'll get it right in a minute. 669 currently in seventh position. A 664. So because it's a better backup jump, she's equal with Sawyers. So she moves up one place. So she won't be the next up. It all gets very confusing, doesn't it? So 664 means that she's now up into seventh. She replaces Sawyers, who's also jumped 669, but has a lower second jump to back up her 69. So Sawyers will be the eighth and the first to jump in the fourth round when they reschedule and juggle the pack.
Well, Sean Merritt, part of the three men who created Olympic history in the 400 metres. He would have preferred the gold, as he secured in 2008, but it was bronze in the four. Merritt is the fastest man in the world this year over the 200 metres, but you suspect perhaps not for too much longer. So relaxed, so chilled out. I've said this a couple of times, but I can't believe this is the last individual Olympic medal we will ever see Usain Bolt contesting. And what a fabulous performance it was from Andre de Grasse to back up the World Championship bronze last year with a bronze here in the Olympic Games. And he possibly is at the forefront of the next generation of global stars, because at some stage soon, we do have to contemplate, sad though it is, that Johan Blake on the right of picture there and Usain Bolt on the left. Well, Bolt in particular is coming to the end of the most glittering athletics career in history, and the sport will need to function without him. Gatlin completed a gold, silver and bronze collection over 100 metres. Bronze 4 years ago against Bolt, gold of course way back in Athens, and a silver behind the great man, just as he did in Beijing at the World Championships last year. LaShawn Merritt goes in the first of the semi-finals. He's drawn in lane six. 19.74 this season. He was beaten by Gatlin in the trials, where Gatlin ran a very useful 19.75. LaShawn Merritt was very gracious, actually, at the end of the 400 metres. Ran well inside 44 seconds. And with that world record from Wade van Niekerk and a wonderful run from his other great rival, Kerani James, that fabulous time, this time, was only good enough for the bronze. So, first of three semi-finals. The big man from Jamaica goes in the second. So Merritt, along with Nikhil Ashmead. Ashmead, twice part of the Jamaican sprint relay gold medal winning quartet in Beijing and in Moscow. It's Neri Brenes of Costa Rica. Merritt just making sure he's ready and poised. Very high standard in the heats. It was brutal qualification simply because there were so many of them. We saw almost 10 men going inside 20.2, which is a fabulous standard. But Merritt just going through his preparations. And really, although we said this during the heats, it's unfair to say this, but Ashmead and all the rest, and including Gatlin, who's run 19.75, the way Bolt's demeanour is here in Rio, quite apart from the gold medal in the 100, they are, barring a disaster or a false start a la Daegu in the 100 metres, they're vying for silver and bronze.
It certainly seems that way, but the glorious uncertainty of sport dictates that you never know what is around the corner. But if he stays together in one piece, you would think that he's going to do it, and he'll go 200 metres in Beijing, London and Rio to back up what he's been able to do in the 100. He holds the world record at this event. He even talked about going under 19 seconds. I think that's probably slightly a little optimistic, even for him and what he can do.
Yes, I think those days are in the past. I think that world record will stick around for a very, very long time. Anyway, Bolt comes up in the second of the semis. Here are the world-class men vying for a place in the final from the first of the semis. A race packed with talent, as you'd expect for an Olympic semi-final. Christophe Lemaitre, former European champion over 200 metres, got a bronze in Daegu behind Usain Bolt. He's a 19.8 man at his best, but he's yet to go inside 20.2 this season. Looks nervous. Danny Talbot equaled his PB in qualification. Good run, actually. He came through late, 20.27. Twice a European bronze medalist, 2012 and in Amsterdam just a month and a bit ago. Then LaShawn Merritt, the former Olympic champion over 400 metres, bronze this time. He's in fabulous shape as far as the 200 is concerned. He's the fastest man in the world this year with 19.74. Jose Carlos Herrera won his heat. Good performance from the Mexican who went out in the heats in London 4 years ago. He's gone better this time round. Nikhil Ashmead just missed a medal in Moscow behind, yes, Usain Bolt 3 years ago in the World Championships. He won his heat, 20.15. Neri Brenes, 20.20. Very good performer indoors, former world champion over the 400 metres. That 20.20, incidentally, was a new national record. Aaron Brown came through as a fastest loser. He's gone 20 on the nose this season. Canadians, with him and Andre de Grasse, really putting together a great team of world-class sprinters. and Rondell Cirillo. Heats here over the 100 metres, made the semis back in London. So can he move through to the big final? Well, on times it should be LaShawn Merritt here. It's only the first two to advance through to the final, and we'll keep our eye on the athletes who don't finish in the top two. Nery Brenez, with that national record to qualify for the semis, he could go well from lane three. And watch out for Aaron Brown as well, the Canadian, in lane two. Nikhail Ashmead just going through his final preparations. And Christophe Lemaitre will have to get out very, very fast on the outside. Hasn't been a brilliant season for the Frenchman, but he's got the class to shine if he has his day. Cleanly away, first time. Cracking start from Danny Talbot, and it's taken LaShawn Merritt just a little while to get into his running. And now he's coming through. Nikhail Ashmead also poking his head out. And now LaShawn Merritt beginning to pull away. Lemaitre's trying to close the gap. Good run from the Frenchman. LaShawn Merritt from Christophe Lemaitre. And Merritt has made 19.95, rounded down to 9.4. Looked very, very easy there. He certainly dispatched Nikhail Ashmead. And what a great run that was from Christophe Lemaitre. What I was saying, he's got the class, and if he gets it right, he can shine. I think that's his best performance over 200 metres for a long, long time. He's only a hundredth of a second outside 20 flat. Danny Talbot coming through for third, 20.25. He'll have to wait to see if he goes through as a fastest loser. Great run from Lemaitre, who looked easy, and Lemaitre is back in form.
That was a really good performance from the Frenchman. Merritt untroubled, but he didn't begin that well. It took him a long time to engage gear. And the man in lane seven, Talbot, had it over him. But look at Merritt here. Runs a great bend. And then the last 5 metres of the bend, he makes 2 metres on the field. The man in lane one, Cirillo, was running well. But look at Lemaitre, closest to camera. He's finished off as well as we've seen him for a while in the 200. And he'll go in with a little sneaky hope that he might be able to get a medal. You would have to think it would be bronze, but that is a much more encouraging performance from the Frenchman. LaShawn Merritt looking up at the screen, very comfortable at the end. Danny Talbot runs a personal best to get into third at 20.25, but the 30-year-old, the great athlete, LaShawn Merritt is through, and another great athlete is about to make his entrance. And you'll know when he comes out, just wait for the roar.
In the long jump, Smanovic steps up. Bartoletta gets ready. 6.95. Both ladies have jumped 6.95, but Bartoletta has a backup jump of 6.94. Smanovic has two no jumps and no backup at this moment in time. Fourth round. One more to jump after this. So Spanovic gets the white flag. She's been trying to get that white flag up. She's been fouling long, long jumps, over 7 metres, but she's on the board this time. She's got a bit of space to spare. And we're just waiting for that distance to come up. 6 meters 91, so she stays in second place as we move to the last jump of this fourth round, and that'll be Bartoletta, who currently leads with 6.95, but has a backup jump of 6.94.
Good run from LaShawn Merritt, already glancing around. Could he produce a second individual sprint medal here in Rio? Well, we've got some very, very big stars still to come. But 19.94, a really, really good marker for the final. And what a run from Lemaitre, recapturing some of the form that took him to bronze in Daegu 5 years ago. Talbot and Ashmead will have to wait and see. Not sure with 2025 and 2031.
So you're going to hear a lot of roaring in the next few minutes. And there's the reason why. The man in lane four, Usain Bolt, looking to win what appears likely to be his last individual Olympic championship. This is the second last step towards doing that. And he's got the bronze medalist from the 100, Andrei de Grasse, for company. There's the man from Turkey, formerly from Azerbaijan, Ramil Guliyev, said Azerbaijan had no enthusiasm for athletics, and so he went to Turkey, and he won the Turkish championship at 200 metres. The Nigerian, Odaduru, his personal best time is 20:34, so he's going to get blown away here, you would think. Adam Jamili from Great Britain. Couple of silver medals in the Commonwealth Games in 2014. Really endeared himself to the crowd in London with that great smile. Here is the bronze medalist from the 100 and a two-time World Championship bronze medalist, Andrei de Grasse of Canada. And after his welcome, no words are necessary. They were roaring that loudly. It was hard to hear his introduction. Salem Yakub goes from lane three, the Bahrain record holder. Amir Webb of the United States, at 25 years of age, is a 1985 runner. He's done that this year. Former US collegiate champion at 200 metres. And the Pan Am Games champion from Cuba, Roberto Skyers, goes from lane one. He is the world record holder. He is the Olympic record holder. He is the defending Olympic champion. He is the greatest. And let's hope that he gets through with a minimum of fuss here. Who will it be? De Grasse or Jamili? Looking for the other spot. Second semi-final of the men's 200 metres in Rio. Up he comes and off he goes to a mighty roar. And Bolt has his first target in de Grasse. He picks off his second target in Jamili. He straightens up, having run a brilliant bend. De Grasse trying to stick with him. Jamili's also going well. Bolt's going to switch it off. And he'll just beat de Grasse to the line in 19.79. So he turned it right down in about the last 20 metres or so. But he's still run about 0.15 of a second quicker than LaShawn Merritt. And that is the performance of a man who is not going to lose any admirers. A national record for the Canadian de Grasse in being beaten by 0.02 of a second. He raced it out, but Usain said, "You're not going to get past me, not even in the semi-finals." Jamili's run third in 20.08, and Guliyev has run a season's best in 20.09. But Bolt, 19.78, he ran the brilliant bend that he always does, and it's just hard to see how they're ever going to get near him. He might have a gold medal, another gold medal, to match those golden shoes.
Well, I tell you what, I know we're going to wax lyrical about Usain Bolt, but what a fabulous run from Andrei de Grasse, smashing his lifetime best and the Canadian national record, because he made Jamili and Guliyev, who ran 20.08 and 20.09, they're the two fastest losers at the moment, they made them look average. Great run there from de Grasse, and Bolt rounded down to 19.78. It's over a tenth of a second quicker than we saw from him in the London Diamond League, and he looked a little unhappy with that when he ran 19.89 around a month ago. Laughing and joking, we will see the fastest time in the world this year come the final. He might not be in 19.19 shape anymore as he was in Berlin in 2009, but he is going to bow out in style with his individual record in Olympic finals intact, I think.
19.78 it is, and he just looked at de Grasse and said, I love having you here, but I'm still going to touch you off. You're not going to get past me. DeGrasse with that national record. Jamili third, 20.08. And Guliev in 20.09. So as far as the non-automatic qualifiers, Jamili and Guliev have it at the moment.
Well, we're over the long jump. It's starting to heat up considerably in this part of the arena. Rees, 6.79 in the second round. But she's back in sixth place, the defending champion. She's had no jump, 6.79, no jump, no jump, and a further no jump. So this is her fifth attempt. She's been going way, way into the pit and the sand, but unfortunately, the takeoff foot is past the board. So what can she do on her fifth round? Currently in sixth position. Well, it's long again. She gets the white flag this time, so Rees is going to hop. Well, she's going to jump, actually, past. Well, let's see where that the back may have come down on the 7 meter line, so it may be 7.09 for Brittany Rees in the fifth round. So she leaps literally past Bartoletta at 6.95 and Spanovic also on 6.95. We've seen Spanovic go long, but she's just fouled, so we've still got some excitement to come in this long jump final, as Balta from Estonia with 6.79 as her best jump lines up for her fifth round attempt. Brittany Rees's jump there has pushed everybody down a slot, which is how this system works. But they'll have a chance to come back at her in the last round, perhaps. And they still have two jumps remaining, the top jumpers in this competition. Now, in the javelin, the first round, we had a really slow burning, sort of coming to a climax type of Group A. Now, this is the first one. Ryoshi Arai of Japan just stays behind the line. Oh, and the first round in Group B of the qualifying round for the javelin goes over that 83-meter line easily. So these guys haven't taken long to get warmed up. Just about stopped. He knew it was a good throw. He would have felt the juice on that javelin as he let go of it. And look at that. That's over 84 meters. Great pictures. Look at that. Just stops behind the foul line. 84-16. So he becomes the lead qualifier so far. And we've got more of the best throwers in the world to follow. It's all getting so exciting. Here we go. Mahambo of Germany, 6.83 in the first round, has taken to her to this part of the competition. 7.09 now leads. Well, it's out there. It's close to the 7 meter line. She gets the white flag. Great jumping from the German, Mahambo. Perfectly on the board. Great extension off the board. Good height. Leg extension. Oh, and she's moved up to fourth place. 6.95. That's three ladies on 6.95. And next to jump will be one of those. Ivana Spanovic. 6.95 in the first round. 6.91. She's in bronze medal position now. Just sinks those hips to the takeoff. Gets the white flag this time. 6.91 on her last jump. That looks as though it could be threatening the 7 meter mark. Her feet definitely go past 7 meters. She's good on the board. 7.08. Oh my word. 1 centimeter behind Brittany Rees. Now, we've talked about the field events all week being spectacularly close. Well, we've got another one brewing here. 7.08 puts her in the silver medal position on her own now, with the leader at the cut, Bartoletta, suddenly finding herself back in the bronze medal position, the 30-year-old world champion from 2005 and 2015. Oh my word, shot no strides in. She's like a bundle of springs in there. White flag goes up, smile comes on the face, clap of the hand. Oh my word, that could be good enough to take the lead. Yes, she clenches her fist. Wait, 7-17. Bartoletta goes back into the lead. Brittany Reese in second with 7-09. Let's look at this. Just drops those hips a fraction, but gets back off that takeoff. Perfect on the board. 1 centimetre to spare. And take a breath. What a fantastic jump that was in the fifth round. Reese must have been thinking, I'm in the money here, but she gets usurped by Bartoletta. 7-17 leads.
Great competition in the women's long jump. Can Brittany Reese produce a massive jump as she did in the US trials? Right, third semi-final of the men's 200 metres. We have seen brilliant performances from Merritt, Anne Bolt and André de Grasse. Chirande Martina, European 100 metre champion, originally silver back in Beijing over the two, disqualified. Sean Crawford gave him the medal he was upgraded to anyway, so he does have somewhere in his possession the Olympic silver medal from Beijing. Nathaniel Mitchell Blake of Great Britain, fourth in the World Juniors a few years ago, 19.95 this season. How he could do with that right now. Johan Blake, 20.13 in qualification. Silver medalist behind Bolt 4 years ago. Can he make it through to the final? He only just missed a medal in the one. Alonso Edwards coming back to something like the form that took him to the silver in that world record winning race from Bolt in 2009. 19.81 on that occasion. Bruno Hortolano, European champion. He is in cracking shape. 20.12 national record in qualification for the semis. Prowling, poised and ready. Justin Gatlin, silver behind Bolt in the 100 and silver behind him in the 200 last year in Beijing. Matteo Galvan, new national record holder over the 400, 20.50. He will need much quicker than that here. This is a semi-final absolutely loaded with talent. And Lycourgos Sakonas of Greece, Mediterranean Games champion a couple of years ago. Well, this is really, really tough qualification. Gatlin will be the favourite for this one. He's in three. Alonso Edwards in really good shape, the Panamanian, in five. Blake of Jamaica, six. Mitchell Blake of Great Britain in seven. That's Hortolano of Spain. And Chirande Martina on the outside. Gatlin should set the pace here. Can he produce a performance as impressive as his compatriot, Lemerit? And that of Usain Bolt in the second semi-final. This is the third, only two guaranteed to advance. This could be very close indeed. Gatlin quickly up into his running and he's already eating into the stagger up onto the shoulder of Hortolano, the classy Spaniard. Blake's gone really well round that bend and now starting to struggle a little bit. And Gatlin coming under pressure here. Wow, Justin Gatlin.
Oh,
he may not have got the nod there for the second spot. Really good run from Alonso Edward, who came through the middle. 20.08. And the crucial thing about that is that there won't be any fastest losers from this. It was either Martina or Justin Gatlin for the second spot. And remember, if Gatlin was third, and I think he might have been, he will not be in the final, because the two fastest losers are 20.08 and 20.09. Rounded down to 20.07, Martina gets the second spot, 20.10. Justin Gatlin misses out by 3/100ths of a second. And I'm not sure we will ever see Gatlin racing in an individual race at the Olympics again. So his very long, sometimes controversial Olympic career as an individual athlete has come to an end there with that race.
I just wonder what the defeat in the 100 metres did to this man.
He came here thinking that this might be the best opportunity that I've had for a while. He couldn't get it done, and I think he might have carried the scars.
Brittany Rees thought she might have nailed the gold medal with a 7.09 on her fifth round jump. She was down the field at the cut. 6.79 put her in fifth place. So the leaders at that time still have jumps to take. So she's now in second behind her teammate Bartoletta, who jumped 7.17 on the fifth round. So 7.17 is needed. And that's a massive jump. Her hand has come back a little bit, so it will come back to where her hand went in the sand. She gets the white flag. What a great response by Rees. 7.15. 7.15, 2 centimetres behind Tiana Bartoletta. Let's have a look at this. Great on the board. Now, if she hadn't put her elbow down there, that would have been a gold medal jump. But they've taken it back to, obviously, where the sand is broken. So Rees, 7.15. She stays in the silver medal position. Bauta of Estonia, currently in sixth position. .679 in the third round. This is her final chance. She's got to get over 7.08 to get in the medals. Well, that falls short. Good try, but not good enough at this level. So under 7 metres for Bauta. 6.62, so 6.79, her best jump in the third round. So this lady, has she got nerves of steel? Could she be the new ice queen sitting there quietly just watching? Mahambu, who improved to 6.95 in the fifth round. Is she putting a string of jumps together here? Now, 7.08 is needed. Spanovic, who jumps after this lady, has jumped 7.08 in the fifth round. Rees now in silver medal, 7.15, and Bartoletta leads with 7.17. So it's got to be over 7. And it just falls short. We can see that. Those graphics cross the pit. It was a good attempt. It's a good jump in the late 6 metre area. On a 6.95, she noticeably went higher off the board. 6.79, final jump for Mihambo. So we come down to the last two jumpers in this long jump final. Bartoletta has to watch while Spanovic, the Serbian, the 26-year-old Serbian who jumped 7.08 on her fifth jump, just 1 centimetre behind at that time, but now she needs 7.15 for a silver. Well, she'll need 7.16 actually, or 7.17 or more for the goal. This is it. This is your moment. Well, it gets the white flag. I think it's over 7, but it may not be enough. 7.15, 7.16, because the countback will come in. And Rees has that 7.09, 7.05. What a fantastic attempt. 7.08, 7.05 she finishes with, and she ends up in the new... It's a new record for her, Spanovic. She ends up with the bronze medal. Great long jumping, 6.95 right at the start. She was the leading qualifier. She's now broken her own record of 7.07 at 7.08. And Bartoletta, she's going to go for it. She's the gold medal winner. She's not going to get taken now. She's the last to jump in the sixth round. Tiana Bartoletta. It's another 7 metre plus jump, but it doesn't matter. The white flag goes up, the arms go up, and she shouts. She exults. She's taken the gold medal with that jump of 7 metres 17 in the fifth round. It responded to Brittany Rees. I'll get her name right in a minute. 7.09, and then she went 7.15. Wow. What a competition. And another field event takes the honours in the Olympic Stadium as being a fantastic event to watch. Full of drama. And the Americans go 1 and 2 with the reigning world champion from 2015 taking the gold medal and beating the defending Olympic champion, Brittany Rees of the USA. USA 1 and 2 in the women's long jump final.
What a competition. Another one that goes right down to the wire. Justin Gatlin's got a smile on his face, but he must be hurting inside.
I think he was mentally shattered after yet again coming up shy against Usain Bolt. Chirande Martina with the finish of his life there to take the second spot. And because the athletes in the second semi-final had run so quickly, Gatlin misses out. We will never see him racing in an individual event in the Olympic Games again. So Alonso Edward through to the final along with Chirande Martina. The fastest losers will be Guliyev of Turkey and Adam Jamili of Great Britain. And I think that means there are two great cases for some new names to add their theirs to the podium behind that man. Bolt will be the favourite, but Merritt and de Grasse and possibly Alonso Edward, despite the fact that he's run 20.07, they've all got brilliant chances to be on the podium. But they will all surely finish behind the legend.
And Bartoletta takes the plaudits for that performance. What a fantastic performance. Brittany Rees going 7.15. On her last jump. Got close. She'd gone 7.09 on her fifth round, and that drove the other American to that 7.17 jump.
And so now the time for one of the great events at any Olympic Games as Tiana Bartoletta celebrates. Will another American celebrate in the women's 200? They have a couple of representatives here, but the woman to beat appears to be the woman from the Netherlands, Daphne Schippers. She is third on the all-time list at the 200 for women. And she will go in as the favourite here. That final is coming up in just a moment.
Kashawn Woolcock, the reigning Olympic champion from 2012. He's had a reasonably quiet year, but he knows he's nailed that one just below 90 metres. So we had a ray of Japan throw 84.16 first up. Second to throw in this group was this man, Woolcock. And just look at this. Yeah, the fingers go up. He knows he's nailed that. He could see the point as he let go of it. And that's all he saw, because you know when you've nailed one. Look at this. He's a big man. He's launched that javelin. 88.68. Now, let's hope he's not wasted that. And he's got some energy left for the final, because that will be contending for the medals in the men's javelin final. So Bartoletta confirmed the winner of the women's long jump. 7 metres 17. Wasn't mentioned, but generally positive winds over there. And on that particular jump, we'll check that in a bit, as we can see Rees of the USA taking second, the silver, 7.15, and Spanovic taking the bronze with 7.08. And then Mihambo from Germany, 6.95. Broom from Nigeria, 6.81. And Balta from Estonia in the sixth position. Eighth was Jasmine Sawyers. Stratton beat her from Australia, 6.74. And we had a no mark with Beck of Ukraine. What a fantastic competition that was.
And we're getting ready for the women's two. The 100 metre champion is engaged here. Elaine Thompson of Jamaica. That record has stood for a long, long time from the late Florence Griffith Joyner. It probably won't come under threat here, but it's about the win, not about the time. It's about getting there before your seven opponents. And most people think that Daphne Skippers can do that, but she's going to have some hot competition, especially from the young American in Tori Bowie. Here's the field for the women's two. There's only one woman in the field aged in her 30s, and that is Yvette Lalova Collio. Finals in both sprints 12 years ago in Athens. Almost 12 years older than her youngest rival in this race, in Asher Smith. Michelle IE, sixth in the 100 metres final, fifth in the World Championship 100 final. She has at least 12 tattoos. One says, smile now, cry later. A great favourite of the crowd, Elaine Thompson. Can she double up in Rio after her triumph in the 100? The 25-year-old from the United States of America, Tori Bowie, with a broad smile on her face. She's already going to walk away from Rio with a silver medal in the 100, and she's got a real chance of going one better here. The overall favourite is the world champion, third on the all-time list at 200, 21.63. What a moment it would be for Cote d'Ivoire if Marie-Jose Talu can give them their first ever gold medal at the Olympic Games. She goes from lane three, double sprint champion at the African Games in 2015. Dina Asher-Smith, the British record holder at 60, 100 and 200, now the European champion at 200. And from the inside lane, Deidre Stevens, 21 years of age, winner of the US Olympic trials, ran away from Alison Felix there. So most of the action is in the middle of the race. Talu in three, that lady, the 100 metres champion, Thompson in six. Daphne Skippers, can she add the Olympic championship to her world championship? And Tori Bowie from the United States goes from lane five. The 200 metres final in Rio 2016. Off they go. Skipper's got a great start. Sets out after Bowie. Talu came out of the blocks firing. Going very well. Thompson out in lane number six. She'll lead them into the lane. Skippers runs a great bend as she normally does. Thompson's in front. Skippers is trying to run her down in the last 50. Thompson is sticking on, though. Is she going to double up? She does! For Jamaica, Thompson beats Skippers. Bowie's got the bronze medal. Elaine Thompson is going to walk away with two golden moments from Rio. Jamaica's done it again. Skippers gave it her all, but she was not able to close the gap. Thompson got a great start. She led them into the lane. The challengers were queuing up behind her. The time is 21.78. 21.78 for Elaine Thompson, and she is a double gold winner at the Games of the 31st Olympiad. What a performance. It's taken a long time for it to officially go up. There was surely no doubt about the victory, but she wanted it confirmed. Skippers has given her all and threw herself over the line, and Tori Bowie of the United States has finished third. What a performance by the young woman from Jamaica, now a double Olympic champion.
Skippers is absolutely devastated. She might come out with all the right lines when she's interviewed, but she was the overwhelming favourite for that race. A wonderful performance from Elaine Thompson. Skippers was tight, because when they came off the bend, the Jamaican had a clear lead, and that put the Dutch woman under pressure. She hasn't performed as quickly here as the time that took her to the world title last year. She hugged the inside of the bend brilliantly, but look how much ground she had to make up on Elaine Thompson. It was a wonderful win. It was a great race. Skippers ran out of time and ran out of meters because she left that dash to try and close the gap too late. And this will hurt Daphne Skippers. She was the fastest in the field on paper. She had the confidence. She had the belief. But not enough today, because Thompson is absolutely flying here in Rio, and she was not to be denied a truly historic moment. She's done that. She's beaten the third fastest athlete in history over this distance by a tenth of a second. That is a huge margin. She's still shaking her head. She still can't believe it. Wow. If winning the one was impressive, that was absolutely sensational, because that should have been Skipper's gold for the taking.
Well, she was there in the position to make it her goal at the top of the lane. And when you think about all of the emotional energy that Elaine Thompson must have expended going into the 100 and coming out of the 100 as the 100 metres champion. But maybe it was something that gave her that positivity to believe that she could do it at the top level. The fact that she'd been there and done it a few days before. Skippers, she did give it her all. She will be very disappointed. She won't show that when she gets up to get the silver medal when they make the presentation for the 200. But that was her shot at gold. She just didn't quite run the devastating bend that she normally does. And Tori Bowie has fought off Marie-Jose Talu, who, by the way, has run a national record to finish in fourth place. 21.78 for Thompson, 21.88 for Skippers, Bowie in 22.15. And I thought the interesting thing was, after the race, that Thompson was waiting for it to go up on the board. Now, 0.1 of a second is a clear margin. It's a margin the athletes know, but she just wanted it confirmed.
And also, it shows you how much she was focusing on her own race, that she just didn't know what Skippers was doing. The shoulders got tight towards the end, and she just ran such a good bend, Elaine Thompson. She left Skippers too much to close down, and because she was tight, she wasn't able to run as fast as she did in Beijing last year when she scorched to that 21.63. Thompson was not to be denied there. But it will take Daphne Skippers a little while to come to terms with this. And we should have some sympathy for Marie-Jose Talu, fourth in the 100 by 0.07 of a second. A national record in the 2, and still not good enough for a bronze. She's had a brilliant Olympics. She's gone home with nothing, whereas this woman is going home with at least 2 gold medals. And there's the relay still to come.
Well, who knows? It might be Jamaica with 3 gold medals in the sprints in both the men and the women. It shapes up that way. Elaine Thompson is a double Olympic champion, 21.78. Daphne Skippers takes the silver medal, and Tori Bowie of the United States add bronze to her silver from the 100.
Here we have Antti Ruskanen of Finland. Perhaps the Finns' best hope of a medal from the country of the javelin throw. He's under the 83 line, the automatic qualifying mark of 83 metres. So this is Ruskanen's first attempt. And we're just waiting for that distance to come up. It's short of the automatic, but it's 82.20 for Ruskanen. That should put him in, but you can't guarantee it until it's all over. Vetter of Germany comes in for his first round throw in this qualifying Group B of the men's javelin throw. Vetter, the third German, and well over that 83-meter line. Vetter, he's second in the world rankings this year, with 88.23 behind his colleague, compatriot Roller, who's done 91.28. That 88.23 now been taken over by Kishon Walcott. 85.96 for Vetter. He goes through automatically. Good throwing from the Germans.
A little moment there for the sisters before the 100 metres hurdles final. A moment too for the Americans, three of them, and they've got a realistic chance of sweeping the medals. It was Tiffany Porter we just saw with her sister Cindy Afeely. What a moment for those two. And the Americans with Ali, Rollins and Caslin have a very good chance of finishing 1-2-3. That's coming up soon. In the meantime, the medal ceremony for the men's 110 metres hurdles held here last night. And after a triumphant moment that we've just seen for Jamaica, here comes another one. Omar McLeod with his greatest moment. It's a Frenchman who takes the bronze medal.
Bronze medalist representing France. Medal de bronze representing France. Dimitri Bascu.
The biggest achievement in the hurdling career so far of the 29-year-old Frenchman Dimitri Bascu. He made the final at the World Championships in Beijing, walked away with a medal there after finishing fifth, but he comes away with the bronze here after a fine performance. Just found a couple of men better on the night. One of them, a man who has transferred allegiance to Spain. Orlando Ortega, sixth in the final in London. It seemed as though he was going to be suspended for disciplinary reasons by Cuba going back a few years ago. And he didn't take too kindly to it. So he packed his bags and went to Spain. And he looked very pleased to represent his new nation as he took the silver medal. But a worthy winner. He looked the goods in the heats. He looked the goods in the semi. And he proved unbeatable in the final. And he's only 22 years of age. Very young for a hurdler. They tend to get better as they mature. He's run sub-10 for 100 metres. He did that in Arizona in 2016. And he's been under 13 for the 110 hurdles. But more importantly now, he's the Olympic champion. And isn't that a beautiful thing to see a young man standing on the top step of the dais at the Olympic Games and belting out his nation's national anthem? That was just wonderful.
That's exactly the word I was going to use. He was absolutely going for that. And it's a significant advance for Jamaican sprinting because he's now proved you can do it over the barriers as well as straight down the homeward run over 100 metres. He's run inside 10 seconds as well for the flat. Omar McLeod signals a new generation, perhaps, of Jamaican superstars in this sprint hurdling event. Great gold, great celebration.
So Petra Friedrich of the Czech Republic. This is his third round attempt. Last attempt, he's gone automatic. He needed 83 to make sure that he got into the final. He had 80-17 on his second throw, and he was outside the top 12. The familiar style that has been passed on from the great Jan Zalesny. But 83 metres is what you need, and he's got it 83-60. So another automatic qualifier for the Czech Republic.
Just before 11 o'clock at night, Rio time. The temperature hasn't dropped much right throughout the night, and it's about to go up a couple of degrees because we are going to see a hot final in the women's 100 metres hurdles. This distance has been run since 1972. Used to be the 80 metres hurdles going back in days gone by at the Olympic Games.
And here we have the Latvian coming in for... This is Serme of Latvia, 80-65 on his second round throw. Holds his head. 12th position at the moment is Robinson of Australia, 80-84, so he's not going to make it into the final with that throw. The 80-65 that he threw in the second round is just falling short for the young Latvian. And you can see his frustration as he stamps up and down. So 80-65, 13th. No worse place if he ends up in 13th. You don't qualify with 13th next to your name. So this is Ari Manio. He's got quite a distance to make up. 77-14. Well, and that is just around 77. Resigned look by the Finn, Manio. So he's not going to qualify either. Ruskinen, the top Finn, he's thrown 82-20. He decided to pass his last throw. That could be a risky strategy if a couple of these guys pull their socks up and get over 82-20 or throw qualifying. He's taking a bit of a risk. So Ari Manio not to qualify for the final of the men's javelin.
And the runners are being introduced to the crowd now for the final of the women's 100 metres hurdles. Strong hand for the Americans here. Kendra Harrison, quite remarkably, the world record holder set this year, and she's not even at the Olympic Games. And so Tiffany Porter is the first to be introduced. One of two sisters in the race. What an achievement. Sister of Cindy Afeely. Medals at the last three World Indoor Championships for Tiffany Porter. Felicia George, 2011 World Championship finalist, 2012 Olympic finalist. She finished fifth to Sally Pearson in London 4 years ago. And here's Tiffany's sister, Cindy. They had a quiet moment together to wish each other luck and to talk perhaps about the journey that has brought them here together. Two of eight people in the quest for an Olympic medal. Christy Caslin, as though it's a catwalk, comes out. She'd be handy on the catwalk, and she's not so bad on the track either. 2012 US Indoor Champion. one of three American runners in the final. Cindy Rolliter from Germany, the European champion, World Championship silver medal in 2015. She'll go from lane one. There is Nia Ali, winner of the past two World Indoor Championships, and she had a baby in between, her son Titus, now 15 months old. Here's a woman who has now set five Bahamas records this year. Patria Seymour set her fifth Bahamas record in the semi-finals, and the outright favourite for the race is this woman, Brianna Rollins of the United States, 2013 world champion, the fourth fastest woman all time at the 100 metres hurdles. Here's the lineup: three from the United States, two from Great Britain, one each from Germany, the Bahamas and Canada. And it's Rollins who will be the overwhelming favourite. She's normally so dominant in the first couple of flights of hurdles in her races, but generally speaking, we know whether the others are going to have a task very early on in the race. And that's the way it looks. But it just takes one little error in this race and anything can happen.
Memories of Gail Devers back in the 1990s, running so fast, her speed was her downfall in the final. Rollins will be the favourite to add her name to a rich list of American female Olympic sprint hurdle champions. What an occasion this is for Seymour. National record in qualifying. But Brianna Rollins, Nia Ali and Christy Caslin will fancy that they can go 1-2-3 here. But for that to happen, all three of their races have to go perfectly. Is there the hint of an upset in this balmy atmospheric air? You can never take the win for granted in the hurdles until you have cleared that last barrier. Cracking contest about to unfold here.
Youngest woman in the race is the woman from the Bahamas at 21 years of age, Patria Seymour. And despite the fact that she'd broken all those Bahamas records, I think she would have been hoping maybe to get a berth in the final. Well, not only does she have a berth in the final, she's in lane five after what she's been able to do. So she's got herself surrounded by Americans. She's got Nia Ali on her left shoulder. She's got Brianna Rollins and then Christy Caslin on her right shoulder. There is this magnificent-looking athlete in Nia Ali at 27 years of age. So her son Titus is too young to know about it. Cindy Ofili and Tiffany Porter, the sisters, looking to do it for Great Britain. And here's the field. The 26-year-old from Germany, Cindy Rolliter. She'll need her best. Tiffany Porter, all smiles. She's been there in the big ones before. The mum, Nia Ali. The Bahamas national record holder. The fourth fastest woman ever at the 100 metres hurdles. The third of the American trio looking to sweep. 22 years of age, Cindy Ofili for Great Britain. And Felicia George, along with Tiffany Porter at 28 and Christy Catlin at 28. The oldest woman in the field.
On your marks.
Is history calling for Brianna Rollins? The final of the 100 metres hurdles in Rio. The USA with a strong chance to sweep. Can somebody stop them? perhaps it'll be Seymour.
Set.
Rollins off to a pretty good start, and she'll reach the second hurdle in front of Ali. Seymour trying to drive through in the middle. Afeeley's running well out wide. Rollins has been clean so far, and she takes it all the way to gold. Perhaps Ali second, and they might have got the sweep. Caslin was up there. The time is 12:48. We'll have to wait for the official judge's decision. I think it's pretty close to a sweep here for the United States of America. Rollins has got it. In 12:48, Ali will get second. In 12:59, is it a sweep for the USA? Is it 1-2-3? It is! And that makes the victory of Brianna Rollins even sweeter for her. Cindy Afeeley has been the first non-American across the line. The USA, gold, silver and bronze in the women's 100-metre hurdles, and the gold was hardly ever in doubt.
What an emphatic performance there from Brianna Rollins. A total contrast to what befell the Americans literally in Beijing 12 months ago. They have the seven best women in the world this year. They've done a clean sweep here of gold, silver and bronze, and that's without the new world record holder, Kenny Harrison. It was Ali who came across for second, that flash of dyed blue hair, but Caslin managed to dive for the line ahead of Cindy Afeeley, who was aiming to become Britain's first medalist since Shirley Strong got the silver in LA in 84. They've had the best performances of all the world's top athletes all throughout this season, and that is richly deserved. Rollins adds the Olympic title to the world title she won in such style in Moscow 3 years ago, and what a nice moment for them. The names of Rollins and Ali went up, and then there was the wait as the judges decided that Christy Caslin had outdipped Cindy Afeeley of Great Britain by 0.02 of a second. They are so dominant in this event, and they have proved it here with tremendous class. And what a moment it will be for the three teammates, the three great friends, the three Olympic medalists when they get onto that podium. And that will be the picture on the front page of all the American newspapers tomorrow.
The three amigos. And looking through the record books, you go back to 1932, and it wasn't actually this event. It was the forerunner of this event in Los Angeles when Mildred Didrikson won and Evelyn Hall took the silver medal. But looking at the record books, I can't find a sweep. I think it's the first time this has happened. What a brilliant picture. They gave themselves a real chance. We saw that moment that they shared at the warm-up track. Here it is in replay. Rollins always so dominant. Once she reaches the second hurdle in front, it's always going to be difficult for anyone to run her down. Afeeley ran so well. One from the left of your picture now. But look at Caslin getting there and just getting there to get the sweep in front of Afeeley. But the winner was dominant, as she has been all the way through the series, and she is a deserving Olympic champion.
Great win for Rollins. A little nudge of sympathy for Kenny Harrison, who will have been watching this somewhere in the United States. But those are the rules. She was only sixth in the trials. But the fact that they've done a 1-2-3 without the brand new world record holder just underlines even further how good they are collectively at this event. They've had some brilliant champions in the past. You've mentioned Didrikson, Dawn Harper Nelson in 2008, Joanna Hayes in 04, Benita Fitzgerald in 84. Wow, this great list and this great succession of wonderful American hurdlers continues here, and the name on top is that of Brianna Rollins.
And the time against her name is 12:48. Nia Ali takes the silver in 12:59, and the bronze, Christy Caslin, completes the sweep by 0.02 of a second. It's the USA 1-2-3 after the women's 100 metres hurdles in Rio. And a great view from up above of the dominance of Rollins. just commanding the race from the word go. Ali finished off so strongly, though, and really stretched her compatriot in the last little bit. The margin of victory was good enough, but it was a really good run from the silver medalist.
And what you do get from these slow-motion replays, watch Christy Castlin, third from the left-hand side, because at this stage, Cindy Ofili of Great Britain is ahead of her, and now Castlin just begins to reel her in and only got there on the line with the dip. That's how tight it was for third.
And I think they got themselves organised here to say, OK, I know you've won, Brianna. That's what Nia Ali is saying to her. And Christy's gone up and said, I think I've got the bronze. I think I have. And they had to wait, and then it became official. And now the victory ceremony for a race that we had earlier in the day, a race that ended somewhat controversially. And the man who was actually third across the line, Ezekiel Kemboi, is not out there, which is a shame. But according to the rules, that was the way it had to be. He was disqualified for running on the inside of the track. But I think what we should do, rather than focus on that, is focus on the performance of a man who at 21 years of age, hopefully, is going to be a fixture in this event for years and Olympiads to come. And the man who inherits the bronze medal now has a lot of Olympic Games medals. Unfortunately, well, he's got three, but he hasn't got the full set. He's got two silver and now a bronze. Mahedin Makissi at 31 years of age. He's also got a couple of bronze medals from the World Championships as well. And so he inherits third placing. He finished a fair way back from the great man, it must be said. But rules are rules, and he finds himself with another Olympic medal. Well done to him. And what about the man who finished in second place and ran so bravely? 8:04.28, the 27-year-old Evan Jaeger. He was in the final in London, finished in sixth place, and this is his greatest athletic achievement so far. 27 years of age, who knows, maybe more to come. But even if there's not, this is a wonderful achievement from a young man. His celebration will long be remembered, and it began 100 metres away from officially claiming the gold medal when he started waving and thought, well, I've broken the curse to some degree because Kip Roppert had it all over him. Second in the World Championships in 2013, second in the World Championships in 2015. Ezekiel Kemboi had been the man who had dominated him, but the 21-year-old emerges as the champion in the 3,000 steeplechase. Remember the name because you're going to be hearing a lot of it in years to come. Conceslas Kipruto is the Olympic champion in the 3,000-metre steeplechase. Well done to the man who chased him home, Evan Jager of the United States of America, and Mahedine Makissi of France is elevated to the bronze medal position after this